have all your work ahead of you to become religious and to say, I not only know that a God did this, or I postulate that one.
Right, but I'm trying to start at the beginning here. Well, there has to, I mean, do you think there was a beginning?
I'm all for the essentials. I mean,
was there a beginning?
Well, our brains are programmed to think that way. We can't come up with words that don't include first causes and beginnings. We look for patterns.
And
origins, we look for sources. Sometimes we find the wrong explanations, very often. People used to think disease was a punishment from God because they had no better explanation. They didn't have a germ theory of disease. We're better off, I think, with a germ theory of disease than with God as the explanation of it. And Douglas just said God is the explanation of all things.
Well, I would insert
something here. If he explains everything, he's in great danger of explaining nothing.
I would insert something very important here. I believe that every position has to postulate the eternality of something. So the infinite regress objection doesn't hold because every position has an infinite regress of something. So I believe my starting point is to begin with the eternality and infinity of the triune God of Scripture who created the world and reveals himself. If you don't do that, if you say there is no God, or if you say, as Christopher nuanced it, there is inadequate evidence for saying that there is a God. If you do that, then you have to postulate, for working purposes, the eternality of matter, the eternality of stuff. And so somehow you've got to get before the Big Bang. If everything exploded out of, if everything we see around us exploded out of
nothing. No, that's the point. That's the Cambridge astronomer, what's his name? Fred Hoyle. He makes that point. The Big Bang assumes the creation of a universe out of nothing. It's an interesting way of looking at, of the beginning of all of what we're doing. We're a speck in a massive, massive universe that we understand as can be infinite, but what is infinite in reality?
The difference between finite and infinite is
no, but equally, in reality, yeah. You can't. There are things you can't see. We can't see what infinity is. It's
beyond our grasp to picture the infinity or the finity of the universe. Picturing it coming to an end is beyond us. We can't picture that.
Right, but doesn't that go
either
right to the point that is, I think, is
though it
really
will,
fascinating.
Though it
here
will do that and is doing so. By the way, I mean, If you think it's all part of God's plan, you have to explain the Hubble red light shift that shows it's exploding away from itself, and not only continuing to do so as a result of the Big Bang, but against most physicists' predictions, continuing to do so at a faster and faster rate.
Well, it doesn't.
What kind of design is that?
It doesn't pose any problem.
Fascinating.
It's flying apart.
It doesn't pose any problem for the theist when we discover something is happening, because what the Christian does is looks at it and says, man, look what God's doing.
Well, they do that now. They used to say you shouldn't look through a telescope at all on pain of death. So, I mean, it's the same with evolution. Most Christians used to oppose it. Now they say, oh, come to think of it, it's true. But then, of course, that just proves God was right.
Yep.
All along.
Yep.
It's impossible to beat an argument like that. It's unfalsified.
All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to get into this idea of Christianity as a force of good or evil in the world. We're going to continue Christopher Hitchens and Pastor Douglas Wilson, and their debates are in book form, Is Christianity Good for the World? So that's also available. Collision DVD on Amazon.com. We'll have that all linked up on LauraIngram.com if you want to watch it, buy it for yourself. I love these conversations. It takes you away from the politics of the day and the idiocy of Robert Gibbs. You're listening to your healthy radio addiction. Your phone calls, 800-876-4123. All you need is
The Laura Ingram Show.
Thank you. At this time, had a thought that I would be sleeping in a pine box for all eternity.
I think conscience, truth, and the commonality of purpose, whether it's Confucianism or Hinduism or otherwise.
That was one of my favorite John Kerry's from the 2004 campaign when he was asked about speaking of faith and his thoughts on faith, and he was searching for one other, I don't know if Santeria, I mean, he was searching for another category to throw in there.
Profound New Age drivel.
Conscience, truth, Hinduism, what do the Pacific Islanders do? Oh, okay. Back on the Laura Ingraham Show, we continue. Yeah, we continue with Christopher Hitchens and Pastor Doug Wilson. Their new book is Christianity Good for the World. That has also been distilled into a DVD, which is called Collision, the movie. It's playing in a theater near you. It's playing in Wednesday, October 28th, 7 p.m., 9:30 at the Village Cinemas in New York. Those are my favorite cinemas, Second Avenue, and Thursday in L.A. on West Pico. Oh, that's going to be a crowd there. Well, we'll look forward to that. That's 7 and 9:30 as well at the Landmark Theater, and the DVD is out as well. All right. The question is Christianity a good force for the world or an evil force for the world? I started with Christopher last time. Pastor Wilson, why is Christianity a force for good?
Well, first, not being a relativist, I would want to argue that it's good for the world because it's true. If it were just simply argued for because it has beneficial results, whether it's true or not, that would be not Christianity, but rather some form of pragmatism or utilitarianism. So I believe that if God really visited us in the person of Jesus Christ and really died on the cross and rose again from the dead, if that's really true, and that message is God's message of hope for mankind, then since God's not trying to work us over, he's not trying to wreck us, he's trying to save us, then that message is, of course, going to be a force for good in the world. Now, if once you've said that, and then you look at the history of the West, or you look at the places where Christianity has been most deeply entrenched, you see the formation of the first orphanages, the first hospitals, the first mercy missions, medical missions, and all of those sorts of things are the kinds of things that have been inspired uniquely by the Christian faith or certain close variants.
Christopher?
Of it.
Well, I wish you'd left it a little short of that, Douglas. I mean, the reason I like debating with Pastor Wilson is that he does really believe this is the truth. And he doesn't say, but there are great Christian charities going around doing nice work, because that, as he says, is quite beside the point. And if it was true, well, that's Hamas's big claim as well, that without them there'd be no welfare in Gaza. It's partly true, but it doesn't say anything about the truth of their religion. I mean, and it also, of course, it links charity to proselytization, which it often has been with Christianity too. I think it's a fantastic belief that after between quarter of a million and 100,000 years of existence, that humanity was saved 2,000 years ago by human sacrifice, and that we can throw all our sins on a scapegoat and be free. I think that's pure nonsense. And I think it's wicked, too.
Wicked?
Yes.
Well, that's a moral judgment.
No, I think vicarious redemption is an immoral is an immoral preachment. It says you can throw all your sins on a person who's being tortured to death.
When we come back, your calls, 800-876-4123. Wicked, wicked boy.